It's a great privilege to be able to interview Stan Greenberg for the UDEMOCRACY event. I hope that this discussion is going to shed a lot of light on the issues that are actually part of our agenda. So, Mr. Greenberg, thank you for being with us today. And let me start by asking you, do you think that democracy is a threat? Do you think that people are losing confidence in the democratic process? And could this, if this is the case, alienate them and lead them to refrain from participating in democracy?
Well, thank God you convened this meeting and invited me to discuss this topic. It couldn't be more important. The timing of it could not be more important because we really have seen a breakdown of democracy aligned at the same time with the use of social media in very intrusive and dark ways. And all of them have come together in a way that are leading, I think, governments, leading citizens to second guess. It's the election of Donald Trump, it's Brexit, it's the Russian intervention, the role of social media, the questions of legitimacy that they played. At the same time, Facebook and the other big players in the space really being pushed back. Are they really playing a proper role if we have a democratic society? And so we don't know how this is going to play out. But it couldn't be a more important moment to address it. I actually think we will not address it until America addresses it, until Britain addresses it. I mean, they are the core democracies. Those are the countries we depend on to lead the way on democracy. They're the ones who have been most shaken by it. And so they will have to, I think, lead the path, both in having new leadership in those countries, but new approaches to social media.
But before this happens, I mean, I can see the optimism behind your statement. You believe it is going to happen.
Well,
but before it happens, is there a real danger of dragging the rest down? There is.
Yes. Well, yes, there's the danger of dragging the rest down. But I also don't. I don't fully accept that the two democracies will both have the right elections, the right leaders, and respond afterwards in the right way. Because there's a lot at stake. I mean, Brexit, you know, is obviously very uncertain. What kinds of leaders emerge are central to it. And so Brexit is a huge mystery to everybody I know, as you know, that's involved in it. In the United States, you know, I believe there is the resistance, the women's march, you know, the building opposition that played out in the 2018 election. I think the huge advantage Democrats, I think, have going into 2020 will lead to a repudiation of Donald Trump. You know, that's what I will have written about in my book on this subject, which you have read.
Well, I've had the privilege to read it. Of course, it's going to be published in September, I guess. Mm-hmm. And if I may quote you from the book, you say, you write, that the FBI and the Russians pushed Trump across the finish line in battleground states. Mm-hmm. Now, I assume that this is indeed the case. I mean, all evidence points that this is indeed the case.
Yes.
Is there anything that can be done to contain such a thing? I mean, okay, we've seen it. What makes you believe that in 2020 this is not going to happen again, or that this is not going to be worse?
Well, it might happen again, but you have to get to the core problem. I mean, social media is just a symptom or a tactic in a bigger process. We have globalization around the world that's intruding on countries. Leaders have had to manage immigration. They had to manage trade. They had to deal with outsourcing of jobs, the downward pressure on wages for the middle, and almost all these developed countries, and even emerging countries. But they didn't do it. The elites, I think, were too comfortable in the cosmopolitan areas, didn't really intervene in ways that allow them to deal with the rising nationalism, the rising reaction against the global effects, the downward pressure on incomes, the cultural changes. So the elites in the metropolitan areas were just too triumphant, too indifferent, too out of touch to what was happening to working people. And so you You have to confront that, because social media is like a tool that is available to those who are building on the resentment, which certainly happened in the case of Donald Trump, you know, where a kind of arrogant cosmopolitan, you know, triumphalism, you know, in the big cities, you know, missed what was happening to real people.
Mm-hmm. I think that you can spot the same trend all over the world. It's not mm-hmm. just the two big countries.
Right.
It's not just the UK and the US. Mm-hmm. And I know you've worked all over the world, and I'm sure that you've seen mm-hmm. elites being distant from what's happening mm-hmm. elsewhere, right. and mm-hmm. this being a core, sometimes a core explanation of the problems right. they face. But when it comes to citizens, now new technologies and mm-hmm. the internet and social media make direct democracy yep. possible. Mm-hmm. Is this something which is desirable as opposed to representative democracy?
Well, it's desirable, and I think it's possible if you now have a regulatory framework that now takes into account the kind of dark intrusions that we've now seen in election after election, whether we're looking at Italy, whether we're looking at Hungary, whether we're looking at Ukraine, whether we're looking at a whole range of other countries. Russia and its allies and anti-democratic allies are playing that kind of role, but it's also quite exposed. And so you had to play out in France in a way that was able to be pushed aside. I think we're now dealing with kind of a new regulatory framework, a new consciousness. And you can't talk to millennials and voters that I listen to in focus groups and talk about how to about registering and not hear them push aside information they don't trust, and who they turn to where they have to deal with information they can no longer trust. So I don't underestimate the regular voter mm-hmm. to impose their own filters, because they still want a more democratic society and a more equal society and need to manage it. But in order to get there, we need, at a regulatory level, you need to have more trust and pushing back at the monopolies and the control that the big tech companies have played. But unfortunately, you also need for the Western world to have democratic leaders that are really an example to the world, both on how we push back and defend democracy and how we deal with social media. That's going to have to take a couple of elections in America. I think America is where so many people were depending on it, both on technology and democracy and the rule of law. It's taken such a hit with the election of Donald Trump. He has to be repudiated in a way that is shattering, and that the people around the world see that that's not the future. That's not the future in terms of how to maximize democracy, how to represent working people, how to manage globalization, how to expand equality. America has to set that example. It led the space on technology, I think, and on people believing we had the longest standing democratic institutions. We now have to play a huge role in setting an example to the world, both in the regulatory space, the democratic space, but also the space of leaders that have a vision that specifically takes into account the social media space.
So the Trump election and the Brexit result may, in the long run, be functional, may serve the long-run purpose of enhancing democracy.
Yeah. It's too painful to recommend.
Yes.
I never recommend losing elections.
Yes.
But I do worry, had Hillary Clinton, you know, been elected without control of the Senate, maybe even the House, been elected, and not been able to get anything done when she was president. And so we would have gone into a 2018 off-year election with a pushback against a President Hillary Clinton. And then you would have had a decade of Republican control of legislatures and reapportionment that would have locked in that kind of mm-hmm. Dominance. Instead, you have an acceleration mm-hmm. of the reform consciousness of people's values and democratic values in resisting Trump. It's also happening in Britain, with Brexit. Maybe it'll also happen in Hungary and Romania and Italy and Greece, where we hope democratic forces will be newly ascendant.
So what's your guess? 2015, will democracy be strengthened or will authoritarianism have gained ground? What's going to happen in Russia and China? Do you really envisage a real democratic world by year 2015?
No, I don't know. I don't view this as global. I think, I think the problem, I think the setback with Trump is that, you know, he would have formed a G17 of, you know, of authoritarian thug regimes. He would have happily had, retreats with Putin, with Netanyahu, with Chinese, with Chinese leaders. He's very, Orban, very comfortable with those authoritarian leaders. And they weren't sure that that wasn't the future. They need to think, I don't believe they're going to become more democratic, China and Russia. In fact, I think they were hoping to have allies, stronger allies in the West. And that's why they tried to undermine democracy in Europe and the U.S. and Britain. But the pushback's going to come this year. It started in 18 in America. I think we'll see it in a very big way in 20 in America. We'll see it, I think, maybe in the next elections, the general elections in Britain. But it's going to take a couple national elections in those countries for those thugs and nationalists to realize that America and Britain are not their allies.
Mr. Greenberg, thank you very much. It was a great pleasure to talk to you. And let's hope that indeed democracy will be upgraded and that you will be for upgrading and not for undermining. Thank you so much.
Okay. And thank you for your work.